Hi folks, hope you're okay today. It's good to be with you. I'm just going to make a cup of coffee and just going to talk about preaching and the decline of powerful preaching, and just talk about the history of preaching and how we need to change our preaching compared to the past preaching in history. So we're going to just look at the early history. We need to look at powerful preaching, and if you turn to 1 Thessalonians, it says, "For our gospel," 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 5, "For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power, and in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake." So here Paul is talking about that the gospel came in the power of the Holy Spirit. So hold on to that thought. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 5, okay? So we're going to get So, you go back to the 16th century, coming to the 1700s, near the end of the 16th century, Matthew Henry the Great, one of the last of the great Puritan commentators, was dying, and as he was dying, he was lamenting that many of the great Puritan preachers had passed away. And in those times, in the times of the Puritans, there were ministers that had to pay fines to preach, because they weren't allowed to preach. And in those days, it was in the millions, tens of millions, which today would be just an astronomical amount. So Matthew Henry and his colleagues were lamenting how the great preachers were passing away, and they preached in a time and a period where it was not easy to freely preach. But in those days, they had a powerful preaching. Now, one of the reasons why they had a powerful preaching, which is a theme that runs right throughout the history of preaching, is that they feared God rather than men. They were not afraid of man. When John Wesley, many years later after Matthew Henry, in the 1700s, was preaching at Oxford, and he preached about the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit shook the place and came upon the people, he was never asked to preach again, because he didn't care about what men thought of him. He wasn't bothered about what men thought of him. He was more bothered about God and his glory than what men thought of him. And today, we have a generation of preachers that fear men rather than God. They want to get degrees and PhDs and be impress their colleagues in the seminaries, impress the people around them with their degrees. And so therefore, they fear men rather than God. We have ministers today that do not like the doctrine of hell, because people in the congregation and people on the streets don't like the doctrine of God, and rather than fear God, they fear man, and they begin to water down the gospel. I think of John Knox, who Queen Mary would shake and was scared of John Knox more than she was scared of an army because of his preaching. Because John Knox did not fear the Queen, he feared God rather than men. Maybe today in our age, the reason why we're not seeing powerful preaching is because men fear men rather than fear God. The next thing about preaching is in Cambridge. You had, in the 1600s, a lot of great ministers and office bearers and preachers came from Cambridge in the 1600s. All this information you can get on sermon audio by Ian Murray. If you want to listen to his lectures on the history of preaching, a lot of the material that I'm giving you here can be found on sermon audio, listening to Ian Murray on the history of preaching. So I don't pretend to have all this information purely from my own research. So, men fear men rather than they fear God. And in Cambridge, great preachers were raised up. But a movement came in called the Cambridge Platonists, and they began to exalt reason above the Bible. And that had a devastating impact upon preaching, because preaching was no longer about theology and doctrine, but it became a system of ethics. And this was a pattern that happened in the later 17th century, and it also happened in the 19th century, where human reason was exalted. And when human reason is exalted, the evangelical gospel and truths become watered down, and people begin to preach philosophy or ethics. So Cambridge Platonism in the 1600s, late 1600s, early 1700s, was a powerful influence in bringing men to preach more philosophy rather than in the power of the Holy Spirit. You see that in the time of the 1950s. In Manchester, there was, from the 1950s to 60s, there was meetings held for gospel preaching. And the preachers came, like Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones and many great preachers, and they preached the gospel. But in the 1960s, preachers became more into apologetics. And the meetings went down rapidly. They were packed out in the 50s, in the 60s, they went down rapidly. Because the preaching lost the power. Because it was more interested in human reasoning rather than on depending on the Word of God and the Spirit of God. So the Cambridge Platonists in these later 1600s and the exaltation of human reason weakened preaching, and preaching lost its power. Then you had, in the 1700s, you had the rise of George Whitefield, Great Awakening, and you had John Wesley. And why was it that John Wesley and George Whitefield, why was it they were impacted by the power of the why was it their preaching was so powerful? Well, in the Anglican Church, there was a very cold, lifeless kind of preaching, which was very unemotional. And there was a downgrading, a denigration, a putting down of anybody who was emotional in religion. It was seen as fanatical. So you had some of the great writers of that time denigrating and mocking anybody who showed any kind of religious fervor. So there was this kind of sense of being polite and being tolerant was the nature of the times. But the power and preaching of Whitefield and Wesley was that, and this is a key, what they were in private is what they were in public. You see, Whitefield and Wesley spent time waiting upon God and praying, and they sincerely wanted to be followers of the Lord. So when they were preaching, they preached with power because it came from their own experience of a knowledge of God. And it came out of that experience, and it came with that power because they'd met with the living God in their own private devotion. So that is why they had power. And when they spoke as men who had been with Jesus. Their voices had a ring of eternity. People testified. When they heard Whitefield, they could hear the melting voice of Christ. They could hear the love of Christ within his voice. They could sense the Savior within what he had to say. Because he spent time with the Lord. And those who know a little bit about Whitefield, who can ever remember, if you've ever looked at Whitefield's journal, those times in that journal where he spent hours upon hours on his knees praying, and reading the book of commentary by Matthew Henry and pondering over the Word of God and praying. And here's an interesting thing that Ian Murray says, which is very important. Whitefield and Wesley were not looking to start a revival. Wesley and Whitefield were not looking to shake up the nation. Do you know what they were looking to do? They were just looking to be Christians. They sincerely wanted to follow Jesus. And that's all they wanted to do. So they didn't have a diary where they was booking speaking engagements where they could start a revival and they had it all planned. It wasn't planned. They just wanted to be with Jesus. They wanted to spend time with Jesus. And as they spent time with Jesus, the power of God worked in them and moved mightily. Mightily. Because of their own personal devotion and walk with the Lord. So, we read these words. Verse 5. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power, and in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. So they preached with power. They were often mocked. They were often attacked. They were often humiliated. But they feared God rather than men. They just lived for Jesus. And they didn't care what men thought. And as they spent time with Jesus, the power of God worked in their lives. And God blessed their ministry. If you want to see powerful preaching, then don't fear men. Be what you are in private as to what you are in public. and the anointing of God will fall upon your ministry. That's the lesson we learn from the history of preaching and from this verse. God bless you.